of the 12th International Research Conference of General Sir John Kutalawala Defence University. Now, you are here with us in the Management, Social Sciences and Humanities session based on the theme, Challenges in Marketing and Entrepreneurship in the Face of New Technologies.
This session will be chaired by Dinesh Samarasinghe, the Head of Department of Department of Management of Technology, Faculty of Business, University of Moratuwa, while the rapporteur will be Ms. Didi Vakuye. Ladies and gentlemen, we have the honor of giving a brief introduction of the chairperson of this session, Dr. Dinesh Samarasinghe.
Dr. Samaranayake obtained his bachelor's degree, Bachelor of Science in Marketing Management from University of Sri Jayawardenepura and Master of Business Administration in Marketing from University of Colombo. And he was conferred with a PhD in Marketing from University of Colombo. He is a member of Sri Lanka Institute of Marketing, and his teaching areas are included in Marketing Management, Marketing Research, Business Research Methods, Strategic Management, International Marketing, Model Management, and Strategic Management.
He is presently working as the Head of Department of Department of Management of Technology, Faculty of Business, University of Moratuwa. Further, he has been working as a visiting lecturer for many prestigious academic institutions of Sri Lanka. He is a professional consultant and a trainer. He is also a prolific researcher in the field of marketing.
Sir, we are honored with your presence today.
Now, we cordially invite the presenters to the tables. DM Mudalige, Dinesh Gunasinghe.
We cordially invite Dr. Dinesh Samarasinghe to commence the session.
Thank you very much. On track, relevant to challenges in marketing and entrepreneurship. At this session, we have four papers. I see wide variety, including entrepreneurship and marketing. Therefore, it can be a very fruitful session. You all can enjoy that. But there are some ground rules I have to brief before you start the presentation. You will be given maximum 15 minutes for the presentation. And time management is very important. Therefore, we are going to signal the time like this. At the end of the 10th minute in your presentation, we will ring the bell once. And at the end of the 15th minute, we will ring the bell twice. Therefore, please follow the time management. And we have four papers. I think wide variety we can enjoy. Therefore, I think we can start the session. Thank you very much. Of an effective framework for social entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. There are two authors. One is going to present Mr. Dr. DM Mudalige from University of Moratuwa. You are invited to make your presentation.
Good morning, and thank you everybody. Our research, it was conducted by two researchers, Abeydeera and myself. Our topic is development of an effective framework for social entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. So I'm going to present the problem statement, then the methodology, data analysis, findings, and the conclusion and implications. So if you look at the concept of social entrepreneurship, it is basically a subsector, or we call it a subtopic of entrepreneurship. The main difference between general entrepreneurship and social entrepreneurship is basically, you have started the entrepreneurship activity for a social purpose. That means social welfare is part of your mission. That's what differentiates normal entrepreneurship and the social entrepreneurship. Second thing is, you should have two models. First one is the profit, like a general normal entrepreneurship activity. Second thing is, social welfare is also embodied in your mission. So traditional businesses ideas can come from identifying a social need, but social entrepreneurs, the difference is the motivation. Now, if you want to solve the major concern is solving the social issue or the problem, then it becomes a social enterprise. If your main objective is to make a profit from this social need or the social problem, it becomes a general entrepreneurship. So if you look at that figure, you can see if you are making, your objective is making profit, it becomes normal organization. If your objective is making social welfare, it becomes more like an NGO, charity work. Social enterprises are between. They make a profit as well as a sustainable profit as well as make an influence to the society. So these are some of the examples they have highlighted for social entrepreneurship. So probably you have heard about Arvind Eye Care. So that person, the doctor, the eye surgeon started the work. The main objective of his initiative is to make the blind people in New Delhi and so many other parts of India to give them a facility. Actually, it is even free. How does he earn money for that one? He has a luxurious eye hospital where all the facilities are available, where they charge very high prices. The cash flow or the profit from that one is used for the poor people's hospital. One World Health is basically another enterprise which uses, you know, when you are developing pharmaceuticals, a lot of research is carried out, and when they develop the pharmaceutical, that particular medicine, then it is tested. When testing, some of the medicines fail because of the side effects. So then they throw it out. All the research and development, all this cost actually goes in waste. Now what they do is, they take this medicine, they buy this medicine, and they give it to the very poor countries where the side effect can be tolerable compared to the size of the disease or the size of the impact. So their main objective is not to profit, not to make a profit by selling these medicines, which we call not the perfect medicine, the downgraded medicine, but to make the life better. So Grameen Bank also given as an example. So if you look at the Sri Lankan system, Sri Lankan context, social entrepreneurship is very less studied. At least it's, actually it is at the very early stage. So, and we also found that in many articles, poverty, many countries what they do is they give like some of the charity kind of a incentive for these poor people. What we found in the literature is that social entrepreneurship is one way to overcome poverty. Not by giving somebody, not by transferring money from the rich people to the poor, but making them entrepreneurs, making them starting their own business. And not only for the purpose of making a profit, but making lives better. So if you look at the Sri Lankan context, 1.4 million some of the beneficiaries are there, and they are just waiting for their some of the not doing anything entrepreneurial, not doing anything social benefit, but they are just getting the some of it. So we can actually overcome that one through social entrepreneurship. So this is our objective. First thing is to do a study on the current status of social entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. Then identify what are business models available and develop an effective social entrepreneurship model. And finally, to propose a roadmap for the social entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. So we use the qualitative method, case study method. We interviewed 8 people. We selected them to cover the top 4 sectors, industry sectors, actually in social entrepreneurship sectors, manufacturing, agriculture, creative industry, and recycling sector. So those are the top 4 categories in the social entrepreneurship list. All the respondents were from Western province, only one was taken from the Eastern province, because the majority of the enterprises are located in Western province. We selected Eastern province to make a comparison. So samples were selected based on different education levels and gender and different sources of funding to kind of compare. So we had, I told you, we have 8 respondents. They have a variety of backgrounds. Actually, 2 are not social entrepreneurs. They basically kind of give the connectivity between the social entrepreneurs. They act as the facilitators. First 2 is basically the network building people. The other 6 are doing some business. Major concern is how do I give something to the society while making a profit. So if you look at those things, recycling of plastic, low cost eco-friendly houses, upcycling waste material, And sometimes some people consider employment of like disabled people, underprivileged women, even jobless youth as a social entrepreneurship activity. So that is also we have taken as the aim. So this is actually not from our research. We have looked at different literature, different sources, and we have found out these things about social entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. This is a synthesis of what we have today. So if you look at the social entrepreneurship objectives, majority of them started the entrepreneurship behavior with the intention of creating employment for a particular group, as I told you, disabled or particular segment of the society. To improve social segment like farmers, that is another major concern, make access to quality products, or let's say healthy product or something like that. So if you look at the policy making and support, majority of the respondents say that government is not supporting, government has no kind of clear framework for that one, and most of them said we started because we have a passion. We started because we want to do this one and we did not wait until the government gives us the facilities. So as I told you, 6th and 8th entrepreneurs actually looked at the employment development as their major concern. One actually used disabled people, 100% disabled people. One actually used disadvantaged women, poor women actually without jobs for their employment. They have huge competition from traditional businesses, but the one thing they do is they market through social media. This is our differentiation. This is what we do for the society. So their marketing is mostly kind of PR, public relations. And one thing we can get the advantage is lot of actually traditional businesses waste lot of money for marketing and promotional activities. If you start a social entrepreneurship activity or a initiative, your marketing is automatic. People like to buy from you because they know your product, your organization is doing something good for the society. So, using an existing model, this is the business model, we expanded it to the social entrepreneurship, social enterprises. So if you look at this one, economic impact, the profit and the cost, that is the model. So you have several attributes, key resources, customer segment, customer relationship, value proposition, what are your major profit sources and the cost sources. So we added to that one social impact, and we studied all these 8 initiatives, and we developed the canvas. We call this one business model canvas for the 8 respondents. I did not show it here because it's very lengthy, but our main thing is we added this column and we analyzed all the 8 initiatives. Finally, the main outcome of the discussion is then we develop a roadmap using the data that we found from those 8 respondents. First one is we have to create a social entrepreneur friendly environment. So that means the government should work with the entrepreneurs and try to develop a what we call a conducive environment. Policies, the environment, the tax and all the other things. Second thing is you have to support the entrepreneur with the knowledge and other facilities. Then designing, I hope they can use this particular model to evaluate. If you go to a bank, then they might be reluctant to give a loan because it just does not show the real impact. Social impact is neglected. So if you can use this one and show to the bank or the other investors, look, we are having a different value proposition, then sometimes it may be accepted. Social implementation and networking is very important because most of the social entrepreneurs do with the networking. They have the network with their colleagues and that's how they get the raw materials, that's how they get the marketing done. In conclusion, so we cannot develop a universal business model because it changes every time and Sri Lankan context is different, and so we have used that particular model. So that's about it. So limitation, as I told you, we took a judgmental sampling and different segments, different geographical locations, they may have different problems. That's about it.
Session at the end for the question and answer. Therefore, we can keep all these things. Then, thank you very much. And our second presenter, that is B. Mahakumbura, D. Sewwandi, T. Liayange, and MMLC Gunathilake. They are going to present a study on adopting online review management as a new strategy beyond traditional media marketing tools, with special reference to TV advertising.
Good morning everyone, I'm Dinesh and our research was done by Mahakumbura and me. Our research topic is a study on adapting online review management as a new strategy beyond traditional media marketing tools with special reference to TV advertisements. Our presentation is have two sessions. The first session is done by me and the second part is done by my colleague Tiran. When we talk about our research problem, out of many industries, we selected cosmetic industry where the credibility plays a big role, and most of the target group is young crowd. And in our industry, we found that most of the companies highly invest on traditional media marketing tools like TV advertisements, but their main target group is young crowd, but the young crowd is more into internet things. So there we found the gap in the society. Even though companies highly invest on traditional media marketing tools, the target group is not using those media tools. We know that if we want to watch a TV program, in order to skip those unnecessary TV advertisements, we usually watch them on YouTube or POTV. So there we found that gap. Our research primary objective was to examine the importance of online review management as a new marketing tool. And there were two specific objectives. First one is to examine the impact of online reviews for purchasing vision and brand loyalty of customers. And the second one is recommend companies to focus on online review management by showing the effectiveness of online review management. And there were two research questions. The first one is, what is the effect of online reviews on customers purchasing vision and brand loyalty? And the second was, how successful are online reviews than traditional media advertising tools? Our research, our literature review was divided into 10 topics. That means our main topic was divided into 10 subtopics. The first one is online review management, and these are the findings and credibility of online reviews, weaknesses in traditional media marketing, online reviews as a new trend, online reviews versus television advertising, and traditional media marketing versus online reviews, and these are the other topics. And this is our conceptual framework and hypothesis. Our conceptual framework had three independent variables and one mediating variable and another dependent variable: source, message, and receive of the independent variables, and credible online reviews with the mediating variable. And dependent variable is brand image. So from this conceptual framework, we made four hypotheses. The first hypothesis is source has an effect on credible online reviews, and the second hypothesis is message has an effect on credible online reviews, and the third hypothesis is receiver has an effect on credible online reviews, and the fourth hypothesis was credible online reviews mediate the impact of source, message, receiver on brand image. And this is our research design. Our philosophy was positivism, and the approach is deductive, and we used strategies, surveys, and choice in one method, and time horizon is cross-sectional, and we use technical techniques like data screening and data analysis. And this is our operationalized table, and we had 5 variables, and for those separate variables we found some indicators to measure source. We use tendency, reputation, exposure, prior use, emotional status, and all. And we covered those indicators by our questionnaire. And these are the question numbers which we covered. And for message, indicators were review quality, review consistency, review sidedness, and all. And this is credibility of online reviews. We measure credibility of online reviews by platforms, characteristics of the source, review consistency and tone. And receiver, we measure receiver by his prior knowledge, personal brand loyalty, amount of knowledge about the product, and this is the last variable is brand image. We measure brand image by sales, word of mouth, financial position, market share, and and this is the end of my session, and I hand over this to my colleague Chira. Thank you.
Thank you, Dinesh. So in our research, we used both secondary and primary data. So secondary data we used in the literature review, and primary data we gathered from surveys. And when talking about our target population, we took it as the internet users in the Western province. And our target sample was KDU undergraduates. And so when talking about our entry accuracy, we gave 123 questionnaires, and then from that we found 12 questionnaires which were out of the population, and then 10 outliers. So altogether we went with 101 questionnaires, and then we didn't have any missing data since we used the Google Forms required option. And when talking about our reliability test, so we have got, as you can see in the table, we have got all the figures more than 0.6, so therefore our data we can consider as reliable. And then when talking about the GMMR test, we can say that our data is scientifically valid from the result we have got, since it's between 0 to 1. And then in the normality test, as you can see, we have skewness and courtesies. So in skewness, we can see it's the values are between minus 1 to plus 1. And then in the courtesies, the values are between 3 to plus 1. So we can see our data is normally distributed. And it's also that we have done the linearity test as well. And when talking about the multicollinearity test, we can see the confidence level is greater than 0.1 in our results. And the VIF value is less than 10. Therefore, we can see that we don't have multicollinearity. And in correlation, we can see our R square value is between minus 1 and plus 1. And the significance is P value, that is less than 0.05. Therefore, the hypotheses are, we can say that they are strongly positive, they have strong positive relationships. And in the descriptive statistics, we can see the, like 70% people, they have written online reviews. And around 90% people, they have checked online reviews before purchasing a product. So in the regression, we have done the regression test with Warren and Kim. So, and we did the sober test because we had a mediating variable. So in that, we got the value 1.96. So therefore, we can see that we have a mediating effect between credibility of online reviews towards brand image. So this is the discussion. So since I presented the statistical data, so our p-value is 0.05. So all our hypotheses 1, 2, 3, 4. So they have all positive impact towards the hypothesis. And then the fourth hypothesis, we can see that there is a mediating effect. And when talking about findings, so we have given the answers to our research questions. So the first one, we can say the traditional media are ineffective. And then we found that new internet-based media are emerging. And then online reviews, trustworthy, personalized, two-way communication go. And for the second research question, we found that credible online reviews will help in developing a proper brand image for a company rather than traditional media marketing. And story of a real user is much more credible. So these things we found from the research question. So, and the directions for further research, we can say like to do more qualitative research because we did a quantitative research, and then do more focus group and interview discussions, and then to have large sample with ability to generalize. And this is our reference list. Thank you
very much, Ms. Sewwandi and Mr. Liayange for the interesting presentation with the quantitative analysis. Thank you. Then, in the line, we have the third paper to be presented by MMAT Kumari, SR Weerawarna, MMM Jayarathne, and WDUH the male. The paper is on determinants of entrepreneurial intentions of students with special reference to undergraduates of Sri Lanka. Please.
Thank you.
So according to the regression analysis, this is performed with the variables gender, handicap, education and personal attitude. So here shows the Determinants and testers run to check the autocorrelation in the residuals of regression analysis. So as Determinants and we always have a value between 0 and 4. So a value of 2.0 means that there is no autocorrelation detected in the sample. So according to this table, there is no serial correlation among each effective variable to network connectivity by having 2.161 Determinants statistics and the observations are independent. So here shows the correlations. So the ANOVA significance have used to find whether the independent variables influence the dependent variable. So according to the table, model can be accepted as there is a significance value of 0.000. And here shows the coefficient. So you can see the beta value. So according to the coefficient value, we can have the findings like according to the research findings, the education and personal attitude shows a positive relationship with entrepreneurial intention. According to the table, as beta equals 0.524 and t equals 7.0030, entrepreneurial intention can be increased when personal attitudes to creativity for independence of the person is increased. Because we measure it through the variable and equal independence. And then according to the findings, if a person has undergone the proper entrepreneurship education, their intention towards entrepreneurship is high, and gender and entrepreneurial intention have a negative relationship. But males are more likely to be self-employed than females, and the students who were self-employed parents does not show high intention towards entrepreneurship as our findings. So these are our recommendations. For the gender difference, we showed that females are not more towards to entrepreneurship than males, so we can encourage women by establishing societies for women entrepreneurs things. Then we can motivate our young entrepreneurs by encouraging TV programs such as Pulse programs. And to assist us to find capital, we can use introducing new loan systems, government subsidies and power programs. So other than that, we can include entrepreneur syllabus in school education. Here is the power program and Pulse program. New ideas can be presented by the entrepreneur. Entrepreneurial ideas can be presented for the group of professional entrepreneurs. So if the idea has a positive impact, so then the entrepreneurs will financially feedback for those entrepreneurs. And same as the Pulse program. And the graduate loans, if the undergraduate entrepreneur plans are approved by the authorized institutions, they can have a loan if the interest will be half interest will be paid by the government. So in our research, the limitations are questionnaires sent to similar age group who has same qualifications. And the sample will be consisted of lesser number of entrepreneurs, because we have focused on entrepreneurs in Sri Lanka. And the first research is open with respect to advanced level children in order to analyze their beginnings of entrepreneurship. And here are our references. Thank you.
Thank you very much for making a recent presentation about the university students' entrepreneurial education. I'm the topic. Thank you very much. Then we have the last presentation in the first session. Last presentation to be made by SD Gunasinghe, GMMR Gamlath, NS Fernando, and WDVHD Mel. The topic is about factors affecting customers' intention towards adoption of the internet bank.
Good morning, everyone. ladies and gentlemen. We are finally under the list of Better Research on Undergraduate Defense University. Our research is on factors affecting customers' intention towards the adoption of internet banking. The first part is will be done by me, and the second part will be done by Sharon. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I'll give a brief introduction what is internet banking. According to Khan, 2007, the author has defined internet banking include a system that can be used by financial institutions, individuals or industries to personal accounts, commercial transactions or get details on financial effects and their benefits via any kind of convenient medium of different networks. Ladies and gentlemen, internet banking has revolutionized the banking industry by uplifting service standards, also providing customers to eco-friendly, fast, effective transaction platform while saving their resources and their time as well. According to Central Bank annual report, there are 25 licensed commercial banks. All licensed commercial banks have now introduced their internet. According to with the aim of uplifting and enhancing their company profile. According to Central Bank annual report, there are 15 million bank account holders. Among them, less than 5% account holders using internet banking. In another way, there are 5 million internet connections. According to Telecommunication Regulatory Commission, there are 5 million internet connections exist during the year 2016. Ladies and gentlemen, so there's a gap. In one side, the digital infrastructure, knowledge of using internet is developing. But the other side, customers are lagging behind or show a resistive behavior when accepting reverse technology for their banking or any kind of their day-to-day life. Also, there are very limited number of researchers has done using both technological acceptance model and theory of planned behavior advance. So there are very limited number of research has done to identify the risk influence when a customer is accepting internet banking. So these are the figures that we have taken from Central Bank annual report 2016. Clearly we can see from the total transaction volume, there are only 10% transaction was done via internet banking. Our research objective was to determine the factors affecting customers' intention to adopt internet banking. Our sub-objectives were first to recognize relationship between attitudes and customer intention, and the second one to identify influence of perceived risk when customers adopt internet banking. And final one was to provide recommendations. Our first research question was to what are the factors that affect Sri Lankan customers' intention in adopting internet banking. The second one is, what's the role of perceived risk determining customer intention? These are critical literature review. Since we have a short time period, I'll brief one article. In 2016, the author used attitude, perceived behavior control, perceived usefulness, perceived ease of use, and other subjective norms. And the author find out that the all factors are significantly affect customers' intention to adopt internet banking. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said earlier, we have used both technological acceptance model and theory of planned behavior. Also, we used perceived risk. From a technological acceptance model, we use perceived usefulness and perceived ease of use. From theory of planned behavior, we use attitude and perceived behavioral control. And as I said, especially we use perceived risk influence for this research. This is our conceptual framework. We use two from technological acceptance model and two from theory of planned behavior and the perceived risk based on previous research. Our dependent variable was customers' intention to adopt internet banking. These are hypotheses. Based on previous studies, the data indicators to measure our variables.
Thank you, Mahesh. Now we move to the methodology part of the research. So the target population was, we selected customers of a particular branch who was account in a private bank. And the sampling technique was the convenience sampling. And the sample we selected was 200 customers who hold accounts in that particular branch in the private bank. Then we collected data from primary and secondary methods, and primary data was collected by a survey questionnaire, and the secondary data was collected by journal articles as well as annual reports. Then we did the data analysis using SPSS Statistic 21, and we first did the analysis of the descriptive data. And then we tested the relationship using Pearson correlation, and we tested hypothesis after that using binary logistic regression analysis. So this is the summary of the descriptive data that we have used. So as we all can see, within the gender, males are more prone towards using internet banking. And also authors found out that within the employment level, that the private sector basically focuses on adopting internet banking rather than other sectors within the employment. Then when we consider within the income level, so between 20,000 to 60,000 transactions are mainly done by using internet banking rather than the other numbers. At the same time, the authors found that although people use internet banking, although the customers use internet banking, there are some group of customers who visit, still visit the branches to perform their transactions. So it was like 9 to 12% like times they have went for the branches to perform their transaction. And also within the educational level, we can see that when the educational level of a customer increases, they tend to move towards technology, so they have adopted internet banking as well. Then authors also found that within the non-users' intention, so they have a very high probability, like 64% of them are like to use internet banking. Then moving to the binary logistic regression analysis. So before that, we did the multicollinearity test to check the relationship between independent variable. So as we all can see, the research shows that it is below 0.8 and 0.9. So it shows that there's no multicollinearity in between independent variables. So then we tested relationship using Pearson correlation with the independent and the dependent variables. So all the independent variables were significant with the dependent variable that we used. At the same time, we tested the reliability as well. So it was 0.7 for all the variables, and we again tested the individual variable as well. Then all were above 0.6, and so the reliability test was in a high position. Then moving to the binary logistic regression analysis. So the research shows that the attitude and PBC as well as PR are significant. So the results again accepted the hypothesis in the attitude, then the PBC as well as in the perceived risk. Then we tested Pearson correlation for attitude and perceived risk. In order to satisfy the objectives that we have lined up in our research. Moving to the discussion part, the attitude has a positive impact on intention towards adopting internet banking. At the same time, the Pearson correlation shows that the desirability, risk, and the complexity of using internet banking have significantly influenced the adoption of internet banking. And at the same time, perceived behavioral control also shows a positive significance, as we have seen in the binary logistic regression. At the same time, perceived risk has a significant but negative impact, which means that when the perceived risk increases, the probability of the dependent variable decreases at the same time. then the perceived ease of use and perceived usefulness have rejected by the binary logistic regression model. Then the findings of our research were basically the attitudes, the customer's intentions are basically affected by the intention, attitude, perceived risk, behavioral control, and at the same time study rejected the perceived ease of use and perceived usefulness, which are in the TAM model, and also they have accepted the variables in the theory of planned behavior. And the second finding was the role of perceived risk. Actually, perceived risk is a significant factor in our in adoption of internet banking when it comes to intention. And basically, we have found that the trust of the customer has to be ensured when it comes to internet banking adoption. So, the elimination of the study. Since we have used a small sample size, the results could be varied if we have used a larger sample size. At the same time, we have selected a private bank, so it, when it comes to a public bank, again, or when it comes to another particular branch, it, the results could also be varied. These are the references. So, end of the presentation, thank you.
Thank you very much. We have left about 30 minutes for the questions and answering. I think they have four interesting papers. I think now the forum is open for any questions, clarifications, and knowledge sharing. I mean, that can be a more effective session with that night. The audience, we have four papers. If I brief those papers, first one, development of an effective framework for social entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. Very much qualitative paper we have. Second one, a study on adopting online review management as a new strategy beyond traditional media marketing tools with a special reference to TV advertisements. Third paper also, determinants of entrepreneurial intentions of students with a special reference to undergraduates of Sri Lanka. Fourth and the last paper was about the factors affecting customers' intention towards adoption of internet banking. Both one.
Yes, it's about the factors affecting customers' intention towards the adoption of internet banking. I think this is in the future is a very important topic of Sri Lanka. Because I talked about the e-pay with some Sri Lanka officers. Most of them afraid of using e-pay because they don't want to take the risk of losing money in the internet. So just now you are talking about the risk. You are talking about the perceived risk. So I want to I'm not very clear about this. What's the risk in Sri Lanka to use the internet, to use the internet bank?
Yes, Mr. Prasanka, you can talk about perceived risk. How did you define perceived risk? How did you operationalize that? And effect was negative, I think. You can further provide a clarification on that aspect in Sri Lanka context.
When the perceived risk of a person increases, then gradually the intention to adopt that internet banking is decreases. So the thing that we can do is we have to reduce the risk of the mind of the people. At the same time, we have to increase the trust that the bank can provide. For an example, in terms of performance or financial advice, so it has to be increased, the trust should be increased. So then what we can do is then we can increase the customer rate internet banking adoption. So that is the answer for my question.
This is the answer you have.
Okay, very wonderful. Very important to avoid the risk to use internet bank. I have two suggestions to solve the problem. First one, now we're talking about the new technology. Apart from the new technology, there is another one, is their management. So why today the topic is very important? Because it's not sure that everything can be used by the new technologies. Because apart from the new technologies, there is a management, there is a human kind. So the two suggestions. The first one is establish a counter insurance. It's the bank should establish a counter insurance. In China, every company, every online company, they should take this insurance for every customer. Every year, just 52 rupees. It's very cheap for ensure the customer's account safety. The second one is, yesterday they talked about the hacker attack in the internet. It's also very important risk. So in China, many online companies, they give a high salary to the hackers. It means that if you are a hacker, you attack the company's online company website. If you successful to attack the website, then the company, the boss of the company will employ you as an employer. You can work for this website. So this is another solution to solve the problem.
Thank you for the suggestions to improve the Sri Lankan banking industry, I mean, to minimize the perceived risk. Thank you. We can propose them to the industry as well, I think, some of these. Thank you very much. Yes, sir, we have time, about 20 minutes, right?
Standing here for the logistics management degree. My question is to the third present. You have been talking about entrepreneurship and then some factors on how to.
We don't want to get you, it's personal intention.
Right? So, my question is you happen to mention that the more the undergraduates are educated, they tend to be more. So you happen to mention that the more undergraduates are educated about this, they tend to go into the field, right? More than the other factors. So I wanted to ask, in Sri Lankan context, are there any such examples, like real examples of undergraduates becoming successful entrepreneurs? So far as we have seen in the world, there are examples like the Alibaba Express, the owner, is not a well-educated person. And then most of the successful entrepreneurs, they have not been in school more than us. Like, we are here for 18, 19 years, but they have been out of this and pursuing their dreams. So in what context would you like take that factor in?
Yes.
I mentioned that we took the undergraduates as a sample, so we took state universities, UGC approved universities, and institutions. So as per our findings, the undergraduates who are undergone an entrepreneurial education in any course or something, they are more towards to be an entrepreneur than the others. So in your case, for the example, so it may can be for further research can be extended.
I think they were studying about the intention, right? But he was asking whether how really it's a reality, it has become a reality.
I just wanted to know, like in Sri Lankan context, are there any real examples?
I'm not going to tell the names of the universities. In Sri Lanka, lot of management faculties and engineering faculties in Sri Lanka, now they have subject modules, minor degrees about entrepreneurship. Programs, and in addition they are having some competitions for startups. Even there are funding sources that link the industry with the individual projects, including my university. Now there are some students during their particular undergraduate period, they have started, and some are maybe multi-million startups they have begun within 1 or 2 years. Now it's there. I think that's a good trend, but we have to talk about that. Awareness is not sufficient either.
Yeah, because I'm a foreigner, so I'm totally new to the Sri Lankan context in entrepreneurship and all those things. So that's why I just wanted to clarify.
But still, I think we have to improve. Still, we are not at the satisfactory level. But there are some initiatives. Thank you very much.
Thanks. 5 stars from the first percentile.
Some constructive criticism.
Yes, sir. Yes, of first percentile. Now, so then you have done a full grading study in Europe. Europe, universal, social, entrepreneurship, Europe, and Washington. So then, at the end of the study, you have developed that model. So then you label it as universal, social, enterprise, development model. Yeah. I think, is it your innovative idea or can you borrow that tech culture from India?
Our main objective is to develop the canvas. Already the business, what we call the business model canvas was developed by two authors. So it was used to identify what kind of a business model a particular organization is engaged in. So what we did was we expanded it to include the social impact and studied those particular 8 organizations with that canvas.
So
that is the one of the objectives. The second objective is to develop a roadmap, which we call as a framework.
Yeah, so that looks like it as a universal, social, entrepreneurship, development model.
Yeah,
so
universal, it cannot be universal like we.
Yeah. So like, I think actually my suggestion, why don't you bring that as a topic, since you are developing that model and since you are proposing it.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, from that you can highlight. So then I think the value of the research.
And the topic can be marketed using what you said.
Yes,
exactly. Yes.
We can bring that topic and other, you have put that effective because
yes.
We haven't checked that yet. So they are better to
yes.
Bring the word effective.
Yes.
A model that can be effective run, that we are checked.
Yeah,
that
we have checked.
Yes. So then I think, yes, change the topic and get this into the topic.
Yeah, that's good suggestion. Thank you.
So then that is for the present one. And the present two. Present two, it was about study on adoption online reviews as. Adoption online reviews as a new study. So then here I have a few suggestions. One suggestion is now you were using that KMO test actually. I saw that to take the sample adequacy. I think that part you can remove. The reason the sample adequacy only for some test. But you have used I think multiple regression or something like that, yes. So therefore I think for that test I think no need to take the sample adequacy. So then that part you can remove. That I observe and actually other thing actually you are not talking about adoption. So that in the topic you are saying that based on one adopting online review. They have already adopted, but you are looking at impact.
Yes.
So therefore the adoption term
you can change
the topic. Yes. So therefore that because they have adopted already, you are managing it. So therefore better to rearrange or remove that part from the topic. And then you will have a yes, so thank you so much for that. And for the author, third author, right? Yes, sir, next, yes. For the third author, yes, one thing to clarify here, now, did you use time series data for the cross section? How did you gather data? Is it by giving a question here, you gather data?
Google form.
Yes, okay. I think normally autocorrelation, normally we are checking for time series data. I think not required autocorrelation. So then instead you can do some other tests and we can do that. Right? That is not necessary. Yes, and for the last word, there is about the factors affecting customer interaction. Now, here we have a few suggestions. So
we found actually the performance gap and also the theoretical gap as well. The performance gap means people use many internet connections, but when it comes to internet banking, people are using it less. So that is the performance gap. So you have the technology, but you are reluctant to use it. So internet banking accounts are very less in Sri Lanka, so that is the performance gap we found. Then the theoretical gap, actually we found less research, actually there are research, but less research based on that we have used two theories, that is TAM and TPB.
So again, plus we have added from the previous researchers the perceived risk. So they were very limited. So they were the performance gap and the theory.
Now,
let's
still think about that one. Now, you are talking about the intention. Intention means they haven't used yet. They will use it. I have intention, the idea. But your sample is, you have taken the customer, they are already using it.
No, we have both users
both
and yes, non-users.
Yeah.
So then we measure the intention whether you have now whether you have intention to use it future, yes or no. So that is, that's why we use binary logistics.
Repeat intention.
Yes.
Whether you have
or if you are non-using it, whether you have intention to use it further. That means whether you are, if you are not non-using customer, so whether you have an intention to use it, and also whether you have not intention to use it. So that is our whether yes or no intention.
I think basically what we have seen with what are factors affecting the adoption. Like if you use that word intention, I think it's actually more isolable.
Rather than
otherwise,
you can consider, yes.
Yeah,
then it can be more meaningful.
More meaningful, yes. So they remove the word intention. So then the factors affecting customer adoption.
Since all these terms have a pretty clear
meaning.
Now we have to have the operational definition
for that.
For that, yes.
So then we have to, and yes, we can think about that one. Right? So then under limitation, we can put because they use 5 times. That's a very interesting. Only 5 times, that's an indicator.
That's the thing, intention is a particular scale. You are using only binary. But to be more insightful, maybe better measuring that on a scale, as Dr. Pali would agree with me. We have about 10 minutes more. Can we continue? There can be more like people who are interested in like some undergraduates maybe, but maybe very much related to your day-to-day life, lot of topics. I think you can ask questions or clarification, right? Yes.
So I think I can comment only on the last paper, right? So I'm very sorry for the delay, right? So when I look at this last one, your presentation, that being factors affecting customers' intention towards the adoption of internet. So basically, I think you have taken the TAM model, right? Technology adoption model. So which has been, for a long period of time, people are keep on doing research on this, right? So when I look at your literature, right? So these are just for your improvement, right? So you have 2007, 2000. So I could not find any latest literature which have been done in this particular area. I think there are a lot of research, available, right? So you can consider those things also to include in the paper, right? Other thing is, you have created a model, right? So in the model, you have just, look at the relationship, I didn't see your full paper, right? So whether you have the theoretical framework, so that means you should be able to explain the relationship between the dependent and independent variables. Have you done that?
Yes.
With the support of literature?
Support of literature in the sense, we did it by using Pearson correlation. I'm not clear.
So in fact, in the Pearson correlations, you cannot find
the real relationship. So whether this factor, you know, I mean, independent variables really impact on the dependent variable. You can see only the associations.
Exactly. If you look at regression, you can measure the impact on the relationship.
Yes. So better do the multiple regression and see whether there are, you know, any significant relationship between these, I mean, independent and dependent variables, right?
Excuse me, by end of that time they had done logistic
binary. Logistic binary, right.
But
yeah.
I think they can go for more companies
with
scale.
Companies.
Yes.
Yes, fine. Right. So other thing is I just want to give you 200 customers, right? So, and also you have used the convenient sampling techniques, isn't it? So, what is the justification that you can give for the 200, customers? Because there may be intention in the sense, you know, there may be a lot of customers, isn't it? So, why you have, you know, particularly focused on the only 200?
Actually, we first took in our sampling method, we took a simple random sampling, but with the reviewer's comment, we changed it for the convenient sampling. So in the simple random sampling, what we did actually in the research was, within 1 week actually, we went for the branch and we distributed our questionnaire for customers that we selected randomly. That's why we...
That is a fact, right? So what is the population?
Population is the customers who want accounts in that particular branch.
Yeah, so maybe how many?
Actually, there were 2,000 customers.
So I think if it is 2,000, there must be 387 sample size.
You could have equal to Morgan table or some instance you have calculated.
Yes.
Yes. And the other thing, I think reviewers might have asked you to change that as non-random convenient sampling. Though you had said that it is random, you did not use any sample frame. Without a sample frame, you can't
randomly pick
people, right? You mean picking people is not random, that is haphazard non-random method.
Yes.
Many people do not understand meaning of random, that is what you highlighted.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's all, thank you.
Yes. And I think we are having about 5 minutes more. Then I can simply talk about the particular papers which were presented. We had 4 papers. If I analyze the topic, 2 papers are on the entrepreneurship. And the other 2 papers are about the consumer behavior and marketing, but especially digital aspect, online aspect. If you look at the entrepreneurship, one is about the undergraduates entrepreneurial intention. The other one was about the social entrepreneurship. Therefore, I can see the topics are highly diverse and covers different aspects. And also, there are a lot of business implications, I think, in this. Therefore, we should appreciate, congratulate you all about these topics, since there are a lot of business practice related implications are there. If you look at sometimes one paper like this online reviews you are talking about, you can see today FB, if you think FB as a television, it's the third place. If you look at, for example, Derana or Hiru, they are the highest in terms of the viewers. If you look at Facebook as a news, television, that is coming as third. Therefore, you can see these online things are becoming very powerful than the traditional media. Therefore, there are business implications. And if you look at the first paper about the social entrepreneurship, I have one clarification about how did you analyze this data, qualitative research, rather than other 3 research papers about the quantitative methods. Qualitative methodology you had used, Dr. Mudalige. Can you briefly explain how did you?
We used free software is available, it's called Qualitative Data Analysis, QDA. And there are 2 versions, like you have to pay.
Is it free and open source? One is available.
Actually, one is free, other one, the advanced one is you have to buy. It's called QDA Minelite. Minelite, LIT. So we use that one and we divided it into codes. We found 8 codes. So coding can be done using that particular software. We use that.
Thank you. Second paper, that was about online reviews. I think they had done a good rigorous analysis about the Weerawarna and Dinesh method they had used to measure the media effect, I think.
that should be appreciated. But to read the paper, they have reported in the future tense. Sometimes you could have directed that, you know, this is a study already completed. Therefore, you have to think about the reporting practice and the things. The third paper, if you look at third paper, is about entrepreneurial intentions. I have a doubt about the sample profile, right? Sometimes you have to talk about sample profile and the particular demographic factors in the analysis. You had taken only about the gender, but there can be other socioeconomic factors as well. Dr. Upali would agree with me. Then you could have made more insights than the simple quantitative analysis, I think. And the last paper, I have a clarification. That is about in your conceptual framework, you had selected theory of planned behavior and the TAM model. We also did some research few years back about this internet banking adoption. We found one factor qualitatively, human touch. Sometimes lack of human touch in technology can be an issue for some people not to use online products, internet banking. Sometimes you would like to physically go to the bank and interact with it. That's why. We satisfy more than banking other five senses as well. No? When you go to bank, talk to the manager, share your experience and other things. Have you found anything relevant to that? What was your R square value or something? Like you are having four or five independent variables. What's the exponential power of the model, R square value? Have you looked at that?
In binary logistic, you mean?
Yes, but there should be a particular measure for you to look at the exponential power there.
Actually, you mean the null model?
I mean, out of these, what if you look at all together these four independent variables, what's the variation explained by the four independent variables of the dependent variables, particular variation? What's the amount? Yes. Yes. Then I think you could have been mindful about that. Maybe in the future you can learn about that. Then you can see whether the goodness or fit of the model, I think, is statistical. That is important. And the other thing is like sample profile. I did see that in your particular article, research paper, in the methodology, you are not that much talking about sample profile. If you look at generation-wide, there is a gap of these factors. If you look at people who were born after 2000, you can say after 1996, millennials. 2000s and after that, generation C or something. No? Therefore, have you looked at the profile of these age differences, different generation cohorts?
Yes, many of them were youngsters.
Uh-huh. Sample, that means?
That means we have analyzed the descriptive statistic. So there we found the age as well. So we couldn't include in the presentation since we
have. You incorporated that could have been a nice insight, right? That is, generation is very important for the internet product usage.
Yeah, in the descriptive analysis, we need that.
That can be a separate research paper even, but a very insightful thing you can discover. I think with this we can conclude the session. We had four papers. Ultimately, I can see two entrepreneurship, two digital marketing related papers. And out of these four papers, one was about the qualitative methods mainly. Other three papers were about the quantitative methodology and made by the undergraduates. Therefore, I should appreciate they had tried to use rigorous quantitative methodology at this level. Therefore, we can conclude the session and I can hand over that to the report. Right. Evaluated the papers, the panel of judges. Therefore, we can, I think, now announce the marks and the best papers as well. Is it?
And attractive. So, may I have the honor of inviting Dr. Dinesh Samarasinghe, the chair of the session, to present certificates to the presenters.
Dinesh and Sewwandi. MMAT Kumari. Gunasinghe. Thank you, sir. I would like to invite Dr. Namarisiri Soma, Dean, Faculty of Management, Social Sciences and Humanities, accompanied by Dr. Upali Rajapaksha, HOD, Department of Management and Finance, to present the token of appreciation to the session chair.
I would like to thank Dr. Dinesh, Samarasinghe for chairing this session.
With this, we conclude the first session of the day and I cordially invite you for the refreshments at the lobby area. After that, we will have the second session of the day at 10:30 at the same place.